October, November of 1982, I saw my first ever hip-hop show. It was the first ever hip-hop show to come to Europe. And I was photographing it for this weekly paper I was working for, Melody Maker, and took pictures of everybody that I saw. Afrika Bambaataa, Fab Five Freddy, Grand Mixer DST, Double Dutch Girls, the Rocksteady Crew, Futura, Dondi, just really pretty much the legends of hip-hop. It was really a renaissance moment for me. I went to the show and all these people were on stage all together. It was incredible, like we'd never seen anything like it. Just later that year, I came to visit a friend in New York at Christmas, and they were living on Franklin Street, which was a sort of deserted area, which in now what is Tribeca. Hey, young world, the world. It was a dark, deserted area with empty warehouses, a lot of artists living in them. It was very exciting. You'd go out on the street, there were kids breakdancing on pieces of cardboard, people walking around with boomboxes, rapping, trains covered in graffiti. Wherever you went, it was New York and exciting, and I really loved it. I just kind of ended up staying. I had a lot of music photography under my belt. I'd already photographed all the punks scene in London. I thought I would just, you know, walk into a record company and get work, but the big record companies thought my work was too gritty.
Back when I worked at Def Jam, I ran a graphic design firm called The Drawing Board, and we were responsible for all of Def Jam's visual identity.
Hey! I'm Say Adams.
I'm Steve Carr. Together, we were The Drawing Board.
People just thought of what we did as putting a picture on a cover. The word design was not even a concern. I wish I could say it was organized chaos. It was more like mayhem all the time.
And the place wasn't that big. Like, you was trying to work on the subway train at 8:30.
Well, there really wasn't any formal training. It was sort of trial by fire. At Def Jam, they sort of throw you in the water and you have to learn how to swim. You have to remember that all of these different disciplines were in full effect right alongside each other. It just didn't have a label. The people that were breakdancing were doing their thing. You had graffiti artists, but the music surpassed all of that because music lives in the air. The ripper, the master, the overlordian, playing MCs like an old accordion. Check out the justice and how they run it. Spelling, smelling, sniffing, riffing, and brothers trying to get swift in. The music is just, it's everywhere. A lot of what we did was try to bring a visual sensibility to the music and try to show people that we understood the way these artists live. And there was nobody doing that before us.
Very simple with the photographer. You just don't do anything that, you don't do nothing that you don't want on film, right? Like, you know, I was taking pictures one time and this dude was like, yeah, and he had a bunch of balloons and I'm like hitting the balloons. He's like, oh, hello, lick the balloon. What the fuck are you talking about? Lick the balloon? What the fuck are you talking about? Lick the balloon? This motherfucker asked me to lick the balloon.
So I started going around to the little record companies. I had my book of punk stuff. And one day I walked into Leo Cohen's office, and Leo was sitting at his desk, which was kind of a mess, I remember.
No, I'm not dicking, I'm not fussing, I'm not fucking. I can make you dip and dope Mac Daddy, slam it.
And he had his feet on the desk, and he's like smoking a big fat cigar, and he's going, you know, shouting down the phone all these huge numbers, 1,000, you know, 100,000, 200,000, whatever, blah, blah. And he looks up and he goes, oh yeah, 1 minute. A few weeks later, he sends a young LL Cool J around to my studio for LL Cool J's first press shot.
When I saw Janette and I saw the photographers, and when I would see them at that time, it was like, so we're taking pictures and I'm gonna stand in front of these lights and you're gonna point a camera at me. You gotta understand, like, I wasn't taking pictures. Like, where was I taking pictures at? My mother, like, with a camera, like, once in a while, like.
I'm not a person that likes to pose people. I don't like posing my subjects. I like them to arrange their own bodies, so to speak. You know, if they like leaning against the wall, let them lean against the wall.
You know, you have all of these people, like, people behind the camera working, and they have all these jobs, and I don't know what they're doing, and, you know, she has people with her, and she's taking pictures, so it was very, it just showed me, it was like a portal into a new world, you know what I'm saying?
It was a really special time, because it was the early years when nothing had been defined yet, and I was young, my whole team was young. And like the recording artists, we were all learning on the job.
And with the local DBC News.
These photos, they become iconic over time. You don't know that they're iconic when you do them. They're just striking. You know it's striking. Like, you know the song is dope. You know the song gives you goosebumps.
Don't call it a comeback.
You know that when you see the photo, you're like, wow, that's dope. But you don't know that it's gonna stand the test of time and become something special.
And my whole thing has always been to capture that person in that actual moment in time.
Well, the thing about Janette's photography to me that is so special is that she has this amazing technical ability, but there's just something about the way that she communicates a message with her camera focused on a subject that's really, really special. The thing that comes to mind first and foremost to me is the Slick Rick image where he's grabbing his crotch.
It was great. I mean, Slick Rick came to my studio. He's British. And the way he was styled, he was wearing the suit. We had some champagne and we were hanging out. We're playing music, we're chatting. And then so he walks onto my little set and he's still holding the bottle of champagne. He puts his bag down on the ground like this. He grabs his crotch, and believe me when I tell you, I did not art direct him to grab his crotch. He just did it on his own, and the rest is history. She said.
A lot of what we did was to try to bring a visual sensibility to the music and try to show people that we understood the way these artists live. And that was really the goal, was to create a visual identity that could communicate to their audience. And there was nobody doing that before us.
Well, you know, I'll tell you, man, boomboxes, that really hasn't changed. I mean, the boombox thing is no different from Steve Jobs saying 1,000 songs in your pocket, man. It may be a smaller device and it may have a different way, you know, maybe we use the cassette to download and now we're using gigabytes and, you know, and software, but the reality is it's no difference, man. People want to carry their music with them. Plus, there's another side to the boombox that people don't realize. You had to be tough enough to walk around and not get it taken. You couldn't walk around 84, 85 with that boombox and them chains. That was a big issue. Tyson, Ison, I'm a soldier at war. I'm making sure you don't try to battle me no more. Got concrete rhymes. It's like the last thing you even think about. You know, because, you know, yeah, maybe when you're running around in Midtown Manhattan with your boombox, people are not thinking that way. But when you're in the hood, when you're in Queens, when you're in Brooklyn, when you're in the Bronx, when you're running around Staten Island, you had to really be able to keep your radio. So there was another, there were other messages in that. You know what I'm saying? And that boombox thing was really important. Them gold chains meant more than money. When he's running around with this radio, you're saying, oh, he has money, he got an earring, his radio. No. I can have this shit. My story's tough, my neighborhood is rough, but I still sport gold. And I'm out to crush.
The thing about New York that's so incredible is it's kind of like living in, 100 different cities at the same time. And for us Europeans, you know, we come from a place where you have hundreds of years of history. You know, the cities built in the medieval times and all of this stuff. And towns that are built in 1463 or whatever. And they're beautiful, but the great thing about being in America, it's very liberating. You know, it's almost like being part of something new in a way. You know, I grew up in London and we had the class system. You know, if you were born in the working class, you stayed in working class. You were born in the middle class, you stay there. Upper classes, that's where, you know, you would be a politician or you'd get to work at the BBC or something.
I do assure that there is no prince that loveth his subjects better.
But America, it seems in a crazy way that anything is possible. Cassette tapes are coming back. Right here. Did you just put this here for me?
I didn't, but it's meant to be.
I shut this. Right here. Check this out. Look at this. So this is from the shoot. It's a 12-inch remix. So when this shoot happened, they told me to meet them at this street somewhere out in Long Island, somewhere near Babylon, which is where they're from. So I drove out there. I had an assistant with me by that time. It was like in the middle of nowhere, dead end street by the ocean. We were supposed to meet there at noon. And this is in the day before cell phones.
I think we probably had pagers, but that was it.
Come 2 o'clock, they haven't turned up.
And we're waiting. And it was, you know, it was the fall, the sun sets earlier.
Come 3 o'clock, they hadn't turned up.
There was nothing else we could do other than drive to find a phone box.
And call the manager, and the manager's like, I think they're getting the rims polished of their, you know, their cars in the Bronx. I was like,
holy crap, the Bronx. We're out in Long Island, the traffic, they're never gonna make it. But nevertheless, I'm out there, so what am I gonna do? So I'm waiting.
And I hear this like roar of the engine. And it was them coming down the road. So I just got them to line up their cars in this V-shape. And the guys got out of their cars.
And they're wearing these bucket hats.
Like kind of floaty looking, loose.
It looked a little bit like pajamas to me.
And I'm like, oh, they look incredible.
You know, being them, they were fashion forward. Everybody was wearing those like a year later. So each one sat on the hood of their car. And they were like, what do you want us to do? They were sort of sitting pretty much like I'm sitting now. And I was like, you guys look great. Don't even move. The light was perfect. I just started taking pictures. And that was it. We probably did that whole album cover shoot in half an hour, 30 minutes. And
it was one of those hip hop stories where, you know, back in the day, people were always late. And that was just the way it was. And we didn't have cell phones. We couldn't get hold of them. We had no idea where they were. I think my duty as a photographer in general is to tell the truth and be authentic. And I feel like that is the thing about a lot of those hip hop artists I shot. They had their own look, they had their own attitude, the hip hop attitude. And they didn't need anybody to tell them how to pose or what to wear. They just had it already. Hip hop is, of course, international now. They're breakdancing in, you know, the south of France, they're breakdancing in India, and they're rapping in Palestine, they're rapping in Africa. You know, not to mention the style and the attitude. To me, hip hop is a whole culture. And when I first came across hip hop in London, I mean, it really blew my mind. And nobody knew that hip hop was going to be what it became. It was something that, you know, came out of the Bronx, came out of Harlem, came out of Queens.
I think hip hop has transcended all expectations and it's broken all records. It's a worldwide phenomenon now and everybody's using this incredible way of expressing yourself.
Done up.